In World War II, the Nazis used gas to inflict the horror of the Holocaust. Because these weapons can kill on a mass scale, with no distinction between soldier and infant, the civilized world has spent a century working to ban them. And in 1997, the United States Senate overwhelmingly approved an international agreement prohibiting the use of chemical weapons, now joined by 189 governments that represent 98% of humanity. On August 21st, these basic rules were violated, along with our sense of common humanity. No one disputes that chemical weapons were used in Syria. The world saw thousands of videos, cell phone pictures, and social media accounts from the attack. And humanitarian organizations told stories of hospitals packed with people who had symptoms of poison gas. Moreover, we know the Assad regime was responsible. In the days leading up to August 21st, we know that Assad's chemical weapons personnel prepared for an attack near an area where they mix sarin gas. They distributed gas masks to their troops. Then they fired rockets from a regime-controlled area into 11 neighborhoods that the regime has been trying to wipe clear of opposition forces. Shortly after those rockets landed, the gas spread.
This is
and hospitals filled with
and
the dying and the wounded.
To the president's speech.
We know senior figures in Assad's military machine reviewed the results of the attack. And the regime increased their shelling of the same neighborhoods in the days that followed. We've also studied samples of blood and hair from people at the site that tested positive for sarin. When dictators commit atrocities, they depend upon the world to look the other way until those horrifying pictures fade from memory. But these things happened. The facts cannot be denied. The question now is what the United States of America and the international community is prepared to do about it. Because what happened to those people, to those children, is not only a violation of international law, it's also a danger to our security. Let me explain why. If we fail to act, the Assad regime will see no reason to stop using chemical weapons. As the ban against these weapons erodes, other tyrants will have no reason to think twice about acquiring poison gas and using them. Over time, our troops would again face the prospect of chemical warfare on the battlefield. And it could be easier for terrorist organizations to obtain these weapons and to use them to attack civilians. If fighting spills beyond Syria's borders, these weapons could threaten allies like Turkey, Jordan, and Israel. And a failure to stand against the use of chemical weapons would weaken prohibitions against other weapons of mass destruction and embolden Assad's ally, Iran, which must decide whether to ignore international law by building a nuclear weapon or to take a more peaceful path. This is not a world we should accept. This is what's at stake. And that is why, after careful deliberation, I determined that it is in the national security interests of the United States to respond to the Assad regime's use of chemical weapons through a targeted military strike. The purpose of this strike would be to deter Assad from using chemical weapons, to degrade his regime's ability to use them, and to make clear to the world that we will not tolerate their use. That's my judgment as Commander-in-Chief. But I'm also the president of the world's oldest constitutional democracy. So even though I possess the authority to order military strikes, I believed it was right, in the absence of a direct or imminent threat to our security, to take this debate to Congress. I believe our democracy is stronger when the president acts with the support of Congress. And I believe that America acts more effectively abroad when we stand together. This is especially true after a decade that put more and more war-making power in the hands of the president and more burdens on the shoulders of our troops while sidelining the people's representatives from the critical decisions about when we use force. Now, I know that after the terrible toll of Iraq and Afghanistan, the idea of any military action, no matter how limited, is not going to be popular. After all, I've spent 4.5 years working to end wars, not to start them. Our troops are out of Iraq. Our troops are coming home from Afghanistan. And I know Americans want all of us in Washington, especially me, to concentrate on the task of building our nation here at home, putting people back to work, educating our kids, growing our middle class. It's no wonder, then, that you're asking hard questions. So let me answer some of the most important questions that I've heard from members of Congress and that I've read in letters that you've sent to me. First, many of you have asked, won't this put us on a slippery slope to another war? One man wrote to me that we are still recovering from our involvement in Iraq. A veteran put it more bluntly, this nation is sick and tired of war. My answer is simple. I will not put American boots on the ground in Syria. I will not pursue an open-ended action like Iraq or Afghanistan. I will not pursue a prolonged air campaign like Libya or Kosovo. This would be a targeted strike to achieve a clear objective, deterring the use of chemical weapons and degrading Assad's capabilities. Others have asked whether it's worth acting if we don't take out Assad. As some members of Congress have said, there's no point in simply doing a pinprick strike in Syria. Let me make something clear. The United States military doesn't do pinpricks. Even a limited strike will send a message to Assad that no other nation can deliver. I don't think we should remove another dictator with force. We learned from Iraq that doing so makes us responsible for all that comes next. But a targeted strike can make Assad or any other dictator think twice before using chemical weapons. Other questions involve the dangers of retaliation. We don't dismiss any threats, but the Assad regime does not have the ability to seriously threaten our military. Any other retaliation they might seek is in line with threats that we face every day. Neither Assad nor his allies have any interest in escalation that would lead to his demise. And our ally, Israel, can defend itself with overwhelming force, as well as the unshakable support of the United States of America. Many of you have asked a broader question. Why should we get involved at all in a place that's so complicated and where, as one person wrote to me, those who come after Assad may be enemies of human rights? It's true that some of Assad's opponents are extremists, but Al-Qaeda will only draw strength in a more chaotic Syria if people there see the world doing nothing to prevent innocent civilians from being gassed to death. The majority of the Syrian people and the Syrian opposition we work with just want to live in peace, with dignity and freedom. And the day after any military action, we would redouble our efforts to achieve a political solution that strengthens those who reject the forces of tyranny and extremism. Finally, many of you have asked, why not leave this to other countries or seek solutions short of force? As several people wrote to me, we should not be the world's policemen. I agree, and I have a deeply held preference for peaceful solutions. Over the last 2 years, my administration has tried diplomacy and sanctions, warnings and negotiations, but chemical weapons were still used by the Assad regime. However, over the last few days, we've seen some encouraging signs. In part because of the credible threat of U.S. military action, as well as constructive talks that I had with President Putin, the Russian government has indicated a willingness to join with the international community in pushing Assad to give up his chemical weapons. The Assad regime has now admitted that it has these weapons, and even said they joined the Chemical Weapons Convention, which prohibits their use. It's too early to tell whether this offer will succeed. And any agreement must verify that the Assad regime keeps its commitments. But this initiative has the potential to remove the threat of chemical weapons without the use of force, particularly because Russia is one of Assad's strongest allies. I have therefore asked the leaders of Congress to postpone a vote to authorize the use of force while we pursue this diplomatic path. I'm sending Secretary of State John Kerry to meet his Russian counterpart on Thursday, and I will continue my own discussions with President Putin. I've spoken to the leaders of two of our closest allies, France and the United Kingdom, and we will work together in consultation with Russia and China to put forward a resolution at the UN Security Council requiring Assad to give up his chemical weapons and to ultimately destroy them under international control. We'll also give UN inspectors the opportunity to report their findings about what happened on August 21st. And we will continue to rally support from allies from Europe to the Americas, from Asia to the Middle East, who agree on the need for action. Meanwhile, I've ordered our military to maintain their current posture, to keep the pressure on Assad, and to be in a position to respond if diplomacy fails. And tonight I give thanks again to our military and their families for their incredible strength and sacrifices. My fellow Americans, for nearly seven decades, the United States has been the anchor of global security. This has meant doing more than forging international agreements. It has meant enforcing them. The burdens of leadership are often heavy, but the world's a better place because we have borne them. And so, to my friends on the right, I ask you to reconcile your commitment to America's military might with a failure to act when a cause is so plainly just. To my friends on the left, I ask you to reconcile your belief in freedom and dignity for all people with those images of children writhing in pain and going still on a cold hospital floor. For sometimes resolutions and statements of condemnation are simply not enough. Indeed, I'd ask every member of Congress and those of you watching at home tonight to view those videos of the attack and then ask, what kind of world will we live in if the United States of America sees a dictator brazenly violate international law with poison gas and we choose to look the other way? Franklin Roosevelt once said, our national determination to keep free of foreign wars and foreign entanglements cannot prevent us from feeling deep concern when ideals and principles that we have cherished are challenged. Our ideals and principles, as well as our national security, are at stake in Syria, along with our leadership of a world where we seek to ensure that the worst weapons will never be used. America's not the world's policeman. Terrible things happen across the globe, and it is beyond our means to right every wrong. But when, with modest effort and risk, we can stop children from being gassed to death and thereby make our own children safer over the long run, I believe we should act. That's what makes America different. That's what makes us exceptional. With humility, but with resolve, let us never lose sight of that essential truth. Thank you, God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Almost exactly 15 minutes, the President of the United States doing his best to try to convince a very skeptical American public that what's happening in Syria right now is, in fact, in the national security interests of the United States. We have complete analysis of what's going on. Jake Tapper is with us. Jake is the chief Washington correspondent of CNN, the anchor of The Lead. All right, Jake, did the president make the case to a lot of Americans who don't see this as a major national security threat to the United States that the U.S. has to maintain?
Well, we are actually live here in the studio, and I'm here with Reverend Eugene Rivers and Leonard Lee, and we just listened to the president talk about his decision initially was to actually have a hit on Syria, and now we're learning that Russia has come into the picture and has offered to be a part of the solution. So let's spend a few moments talking about what we've just heard. I actually thought we were going to war earlier today. I was bracing for this announcement tonight that this is what was going to happen. Did not know that Russia was coming to the aid of not our country, but coming to bring a resolve. Let's talk a little bit about it. What did you guys hear in the president's voice? I mean, the way he started, I made a decision to go to have a strike.
Well, to me, it seemed like he wants to go ahead, but I think he's using some caution with the involvement of Russia and not getting the full blessing of the House and the Senate. So I think he wants to show that he's tough, but he's also wise in his words. That's what I got briefly from the conversation.
Yeah, I think that the president's in a bit of a jam. The American public is overwhelmingly against military action.
Correct.
Congress is not thrilled about it. They're war weary. They don't see how he can guarantee the limited strike not doing more harm than good.
Let's talk about what does it mean when you hear limited strike? What does that mean? It's just shelling Syria? He said no boots on,
no boots on
the ground.
No boots on the ground. It's a military assault of limited duration.
Mm-hmm.
And he says we'll go in, we'll shoot and drop and pop, whatever we do, and then we're out. Now, that doesn't suggest or indicate that there are any guarantees that he won't leave a situation worse than he found it.
Correct. And there's no guarantee that we will not have to put people over there, boots on the ground.
Exactly.
There's no guarantee. I mean, he can incite something that will force more of an involvement from the United States, correct?
Yes, and the other part of it, though, is that they haven't presented evidence, indisputable evidence, that Assad did it as opposed to the rebels. Now, I mean, so just from the vantage point of the international opinion, United Nations, Russia, Europe, they're not convinced, and it's an uphill battle for the president. He tried to make the best case.
Mm-hmm.
He could not guarantee that things wouldn't get worse.
Mm-hmm.
Yet, at the same time, there's a legitimate issue, which is that something must be done. Now, the Russian proposal, which is to provide international supervision for all of these chemical weapons that's transparent, is a plausible option. And I guess if I'm the president, I say, had I not threatened to blow the spot up, we wouldn't be talking about this Russian proposal. And I imagine there's probably some truth to that.
Well, then, do you think, in reflecting on this, do you think that the president understood? Do you think there was some I like to use your term, backroom deals, like the Secretary of State, John Kerry, has been moving around, talking to folk, not having these public conversations necessarily.
That's the way it's done.
You know, right.
Diplomacy.
Right.
Diplomacy.
Unlike the black people in Boston.
We're going to get to that before the evening is over. So, this could be a home run for the president. Just the way that he has thought this through. Somebody had talked about the game of chess, and that they felt that the president has played a grand game of chess, because this is a win-win for everybody, don't you think?
Mm.
Sure. I mean, one, if he can force the hand of someone to get Assad's chemical weapons under some international jurisdiction, and they can cut a deal, the president comes out not looking like a chump.
That's right.
And the Russians look like saviors.
Right.
That's right.
Right.
And I think that's
win-win.
That's one of the big things, as Rev was just saying, is that the president still has to show that he's the president, but yet he has to use diplomacy around that whole piece. But going through the Russians, it's clearly a win-win.
Well, I think it's important. I thought it was very important that before we dived into what we were going to do, that we listen to the president, because one or two of you will probably be asked by the media tomorrow to comment on what you heard. So I wanted you to be ready to engage. Secondly, I think it's important. I mean this jokingly, that rather than being out in the streets watching people have meetings in a field, that we be sitting in a that we be sitting in this room listening to the president and forming opinions and showing our community what we should be doing. And so his strategy has worked, has been very effective, and they have not been able to back our president into the corner. And touche to him for what he's going to be able to pull
good
off.
For him. Good for him. It was a four-dimensional game of speed chess. Mm. And it was a chess game, not a street fight. And he was playing with some tough characters. Putin's a tough boy. And so hats off to the president. And they're going to try to negotiate something.
What do you think Assad wins on something like this, other than he gets to keep his life?
I was reading coverage on Sunday. And the Mideast is... it's just a hot ghetto mess. Mm-hmm. And so there are no short solutions. Mm-hmm. And no one from the outside can come in and fix the Mideast. Mm-hmm. Not going to happen. Mm-hmm. You're not going to fix Cairo. Mm-hmm. You're not going to fix Libya. Mm-hmm. You're not going to fix Tunisia. Mm-hmm. You're not going to fix Syria. These are societies that have been a hot mess. And in some respects are much worse than anything going on in sub-Saharan Africa. Mm-hmm. You ain't got craziness like this in mm-hmm. Ghana or Namibia or Malawi. And so Assad keeps his life. And I think cooler heads prevail. And the Mideastern folk have to settle their own problems.
I mean, look at the Republicans under Bush, what happened. Using Colin Powell to be the face of saying we're going to war, we need to go to war, it's just the case. Sure. And the lies that were told and the number of lives that were lost. And our president did not follow that same path, although people were pushing him in that direction. Mm. I just think for his own legacy, I think he stood tall and strong. And however this thing was orchestrated, it's a win-win for everybody. And he got, and the Syrians have said, we do. At first they said, we don't have chemical weapons, right? But now they're saying, we have
them.
We
do, yeah.
It's a win-win for all of them.
Yeah, I mean, it was tough for the president, but, you know, like they said in Godfather 2, this is the life we chose.
What we're going to do then is that we just listened to the president, and we're going to make a transition and talk a little bit about this election coming up. We have Michelle Wu coming in. She's the running for city council at large, so she'll be coming in shortly, and we're going to spend some time asking her some questions about her candidacy and what she hopes to achieve. So we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to step into a conversation about ministers in the city of Austin, and what do they plan to do for this upcoming election. I'm Pastor Bruce Wall, here with Minister Franklin Hobbs, Reverend Eugene Rivers, and Leonard, hang out in the community, Leonard Lee, and we'll be back in just a moment as soon as I find the right buttons to push. Every single Tuesday from 9 p.m. until 12 midnight. Tune in every single week and be a part of our discussion. Be a part of the information that we'll be giving out. Be a part of the knowledge that we'll be sharing with you. We're hoping that we will help people in Boston to be more active in politics, and we're going to challenge the church to get involved. Stay tuned for Boston Politics with your host, Pastor Bruce Wall.
Spoken, so let the church Say amen. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. God has spoken. So let the church say amen. No. Thank you, Lord. God has spoken. So let the church say
seriously.
And our engineer is in, but I'm not going to say it now. Our engineer, Minister Franklin Hobbs, and Reverend Eugene Rivers and Leonard Lee. My name is Bruce Wall. This is Boston Politics. I almost called us the Cobman Square Update, which is another broadcast that we have over at BNN. I thank you for tuning in and being a part of this discussion, this dialogue, every single Tuesday, starting at 9 p.m. and going to 12 midnight. Beginning the first Tuesday in October, we are actually going to start this broadcast at 6 o'clock. It's going to start with urban news from 6 to 7. We'll have sports, and we're also going to come back and do urban news for another hour, and then we'll come back into the studio at 9. We have more broadcasters coming in to do urban news, so you are definitely going to want to tune in and see the expanded version of Boston Politics right here on Boston Page Radio and TV and WRCA 1330 AM Radio. Guys, at 10:30, we have Manlio. Larry Ellison will be calling in and talking to us about what happened today with the Boston Police Commissioner and the comments that he made about minority, so-called, I hate the term, minority officers. We're going to have Larry talk to us and we'll respond to him. But right now, Reverend Rivers and Leonard Lee, I need to talk with you and Minister Hobbs about this election and about, I think as clergy, up to this point, unless there's some strategy that I don't understand, where are the clergy in engaging, motivating, pushing, calling, challenging the community of color to get involved in this campaign? Are they doing it from their pulpits so they don't have to do it as one massive group? Because if we go back to Mayor Menino and Sam Yoon and Michael Flaherty, I was supporting Michael Flaherty. There was a team of pastors and folk who met downtown, a large contingent of clergy, and then who are you supporting? Were you supporting anybody, Leonard Lee? Mayor Menino and Michael Flaherty?
Oh, Mike Flaherty.
Okay. And okay, so the guy over here, he was with the...
The businessman.
Okay.
I was doing the business.
But you know what happened there? There were two sets of... There were two large, major groups of pastors who were engaged. We're not seeing that in this election. Help me understand what is going on. Why are the clergy so silent? What's going on?
We're in a transitional period, frankly. We're in a transitional period. And you had real talk from the early 1980s, you've got Bruce Wall, you've got Pastor Michael Haynes, who was sort of the mayor of Roxbury, Dorchester, Mattapan.
Being a former elected official.
Right, being a former elected official, which is brilliant. That's sort of the Adam Clayton Powell move.
Hmm.
So you had Dr. Haynes playing an insider game.
Right, absolutely.
He played the insider game. Then we had someone that's no longer here that people don't remember, Grayland Hagler.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. That's right.
He was a wild man playing the outside again.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, so.
He was hanging out with Mel Kings and
Chuck Turner.
Grayland Ellis Hagler represented the black church left. And black church in quotes, because he was a member of a white denomination. Might have been a UCC.
Mm-hmm.
And so you had the activists, the sort of Mel King wing. You had what was then called the Interfaith Ministerial Alliance.
Yes.
And it was Minister Don Muhammad. It was McCall Thomas.
Mm.
And you had that group.
Reverend Washington. Joe Washington.
Joe Washington. Then you had Reverend Charles Stith.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Joseph Washington. And they were in the game. They played an insider game. They were businessmen.
And then quite a few, you're right, quite a few of them doing it together, right?
Right, exactly. So you had them playing the insider game. They played that, they did that business with Ray Flynn. And remember, there was the Mandela referendum to secede, and there was Andrew,
Curtis,
what was his
Davis.
Name? Curtis Davis and Andrew somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
Who died tragically.
Huh.
Right? He went to South Africa. He left the U.S., went to South Africa. And so over, so you had a number of folk. You had the crack explosion, and then you had the 10-point coalition that leveraged off the work that Reverend Wall had done and Don Muhammad had done. Mm-hmm. And so there was a 15-year run where the black churches and the clergy were front and center behind a policy issue. Most people don't get the history right on this.
Mm-hmm.
Once crack exploded, black elected officials were largely irrelevant
mm-hmm.
because they didn't do public safety or crime.
Mm-hmm.
So they weren't a relevant factor. Mm-hmm. So as long as crime was the hot issue, which threw Boston for a loop during the early 90s, the black clergy that were engaged in that were front and center
mm-hmm.
Because violence and public safety was a big issue nationally and locally.
Mm-hmm.
And so in Boston, largely led by the black clergy, were able to pivot and leverage frankly, the prominence of the city around that. Now, what happens, and this happens all the time, and people need to understand this, is that black clergy leadership goes in generational cycles. And so we've come to the end of a cycle at one level, mm-hmm. because you've got individuals that have aged out, mm-hmm. and they're in semi-retirement, mm-hmm. and they do well. And so we're in the middle of a generational cycle. Politically and intellectually, you don't have, good man, Reverend Ray Hammond. He's in semi-retirement. You know, he's doing excellent work over at Bethel AME. Mm-hmm. But in terms of visible leadership, which is not to be confused with simply, you know, sitting on boards, which doesn't make you a leader. It just means you're someone who sits on a board.
On a board. There's another piece that's resonating in my spirit as you're talking. I hope I don't miss the point. While the clergy was still trying to figure out what's happening with the crime issue in our city, all of a sudden, the mayor of the city decides that he's not going to run for office. And we weren't geared up and ready for that.
Right.
We weren't politically focused.
Yeah.
We were focused on the issue of public safety. So when the mayor said that he was not going to run, I think we all began to scramble to try to figure out, how are we going to catch up politically in this town? Because there were only a few pastors who were politically engaged.
But I think it's much deeper than that. I think what happened is, as you know, in a relay race, you depend on the person who's coming behind you to pass you the baton so that you can go further, and then you pass it on to someone else, and then that person takes that last leap and they win. We didn't have the relay race. What we had was a sprint. Because if our leaders were now tired, they would have been prepping, massaging, mentoring some young people to now stand in front of them as they decided to go down to the Cape or to the Vineyard.
Go ahead.
No. I'm saying, you know, I think of that, and I take your point very focusedly, Reverend Rivers, in and around, you know, folks tired, in transition and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But that does not negate, in my mind, their responsibilities to those who are coming after them. At one end, they can stand at the pulpit and talk about young people and we're going to help develop young people, but yet they don't want to pass the baton so that they can take that next sprint or that next leap so they can pass it to someone else.
Let me push a bit on that. And Leonard makes an excellent point. But let's really sharpen this, because I think, Reverend Wall, this kind of conversation is long overdue. Look, in 1983, when Mel King runs, the turning point for Mel King was actually the black churches. Let me tell you why. I was very involved in the campaign, and for a period, the black churches weren't feeling Mel, and Mel wasn't feeling the black churches.
Correct.
Right? Mel King was doing his secular, left-wing, free mumia, Central Rainbow. America.
My dashikis.
Yeah,
right. He was doing his thing. Yeah. Down in the South. God bless him.
Yeah.
He was doing his thing.
Right.
The black church wasn't feeling him.
Right.
Right? Now, an interesting turning point was Sister Sarah Small, who's like the Fannie Lou Hamer,
mm-hmm.
Of 12th Baptist Church.
Mm-hmm.
Mel went to see her at Packard Mance,
mm-hmm.
and Sarah Small prayed for Mel King.
She was a praying woman.
Mm. Oh my
God.
And she laid hands on, you know, Mel was all microbiotic, left wing, whatever. And she prayed for them,
mm-hmm.
right? And there was mobilization. I believe Bishop Thompson and other clergy that Sarah Small reached out to.
Okay.
To begin to shift the momentum, so it began to pick up. Then when he squeaked through and shocked everybody dived in. Now, what happens? In 1983, exactly 30 years ago,
mm-hmm.
after the race,
mm-hmm.
There were a group of us hanging out in the South End, you know, reading the papers. Two things happened that were very deep. One, Ray Flynn reached out to Mel King. mm-hmm. and said, how many of your people do you want me to bring in? Olive branch. And the king people spurned the olive branch. It's number one. And there were people that were looking for jobs because a bunch of us went broke working for Mel King and never got paid.
Okay.
That's how that goes.
Mm-hmm.
So, I was in a conversation with Mel and Marilyn Poston and some other people mm-hmm. that were kind of South End activists.
Mm-hmm.
Mel, delegate your successor.
Mm-hmm.
In 1983,
mm-hmm.
dude, you've mobilized the black community. Mm-hmm. How do you translate the energy
mm-hmm.
that you have mm-hmm. from that initiative? Mm-hmm. That's 1983, man.
Mm-hmm.
And Mel failed to mm-hmm. consolidate his power. He failed to say, you know what, for the next go round, let's start laying the groundwork to do this again.
Wasn't he mentoring young leaders or young men or people at his home with the Sunday breakfast?
I went to the Sunday breakfast.
I could go every Sunday breakfast.
In fact, at the time, there was Juanita Way, Vivian Morris. There was a whole group of left-wing black people that thought there was going to be revolution in the world somewhere.
Sure.
Right. And they were all black leftists. Ken Wade, Juanita Wade, Vivian Morris, Tony Vandermeer. Jim Adari, Kamari.
Right.
I mean, it's all that, you know, Shaka Zulu crowd, right?
They
were doing the black thing.
Right.
Now, that there was a black political task force. None of that got translated. This is 1983.
Mm-hmm.
Then what happened? This is deep. Charles Stith and Joe Washington and them saw an opportunity. Because once Mel and them said, we're not going to deal with Flynn. Because they were mad.
Yeah.
There was a leadership vacuum.
Right.
Charles Stith, who's my main man.
They filled
Ambassador
it.
Charles R. Stith.
Right.
And Joe Washington.
Right.
And McCall Thomas.
Yep.
And them interfaith ministerial dudes, right? They stepped into the leadership vacuum.
So they became the people that Ray Flynn, when Ray Flynn said to Mel, who needs jobs? That didn't happen. So Reverend Charlie Stith and everybody, they filled that vacuum.
They filled the vacuum.
Senior advisor to the mayor, Joe Washington.
No. In fact, Mel King could have produced a senior advisor to the mayor who would have been the guy to broker for the black community.
That's right.
Right? And it was such a tragic mistake.
So what happens when Reverend Washington and everybody go in, all the Mel King political momentum, that all died. That died.
Absolutely.
And it brought in a new era of leadership, but the leadership wasn't momentum that came from the neighborhood. It was leadership that was handpicked by Ray Flynn, and Ray Flynn mentored them and developed them and utilized them for what he wanted in the community. Because, remember,
that's right.
I was working as a clerk magistrate at the Boston Juvenile Court, and I could not leave the court whenever Ray Flynn was calling for meetings. So Joe Washington and Ben Thompson would call me all the time and say, Ray Flynn wants you over here at a meeting. And my response was, I can't leave. So I was pushed on the outside, but I had the whole South Boston crowd over at the courthouse that I had a relationship with. I had the West Roxbury crowd, and I had a number of judges and folk who were backing me and supporting me, so they could only do but so much.
See, and the other part of this that nobody pays attention, so you have, in fact, there's a book written about this. There's a book called Black Atlantic Politics.
Okay.
By a guy named Nelson. It's written on Boston, Black Boston.
Get out of here.
Look it up, Google, Black Atlantic Politics. It's a book by a guy named Nelson, which is a comparative analysis of Boston and Liverpool, black politics in Liverpool, England.
Liverpool.
This dude did a comparative analysis of black politics in Liverpool, England, and in Boston. Wow. And he analyzes the whole rainbow thing, Mel not delegating, anointing, you know, passing the baton. It goes back to 83.
And you know, the other lost opportunity is when now, Mel King and John O'Brien were very close.
Right.
John was more conservative than Mel, somewhat.
Mm. Yeah.
And I remember Dan Janney was managing his campaigns. And when he died, Mel lost that other connection that could have brokered something with him, with the churches or with a more conservative base.
Sure.
And so Mel was left by himself. So we have this big vacuum because, let's go back to what you're saying.
So Charlie Sith, ambassador, he's gone. Joe Washington, New York City.
Yeah.
Just everybody is just about gone into other worlds.
Right.
So it leaves yourself as a player here in the city. Okay. We have the young man who has been mentored and is ready to go. All right.
Yeah.
You got the aging wall, and
well, see, and this is the deal. See, there are a couple of pieces of this that folk have to get. And, you know, and literally, when you get a chance, you get a cheap edition of Black Atlantic Politics by this guy named Nelson somebody or another, right? And we need to go back to, and I'll tell you, between now and the end of the year, there need to be a series of analytic discussions to analyze how we went from Mel King to this debacle.
Right.
Right?
Because this is bad.
Oh, yeah. No. Right. And so,
horrible.
See, and what's significant about this at a macro level is that we're now moving into a post-secular political era. This is what I mean. The irony of Barack Obama is that he has sucked the air out of all black politics. He's the guy. Everything that is discussed nationally in terms of national black politics
it
revolves around him and whether it impacts on him.
Mm.
So he sucked all the air out of political discourse, right? And because the country's so polarized, it's impossible for black people to talk about him, because then you're aiding and abetting the Tea Party, the Republicans, the Congress, and the Senate.
And so that's why when you guys were talking a little bit earlier about Charlotte Goulart Richie, is that if she pulls this out in the primary, if she becomes one of the two,
sure,
it is going to send political shockwaves across the country.
Absolutely.
Totally.
And it might be the shot that this community needs to wake it up, to understand that you can make a difference. Because right now, this community is just...
It's a circus.
It's a circus. It's not
It's
helping.
A universal circus.
Yeah. No, and but here again, I want to come back to something that's very important. You see, there's no one now... Let's just take this. This is the 30th anniversary of Mel King's thing. No one has convened a meeting to talk about what that 30 years was.
Yeah.
No one.
Yeah.
No one. You got a 30-year anniversary.
Yeah.
You got a black woman running for mayor.
Right.
And no one has done the homework to say, okay, let's follow.
What happened?
Right. No. You got 30 years of important history, right?
Right.
You got a black president.
Right.
And you have a completely disorganized black community in Boston.
Yeah.
30 years after a black dude ran who was unlikely, you know, too big and black,
right,
and squeezed through.
Right.
Now, first of all, that's an amazing thing that a black dude who looked like Mel King became the one of the two in 83.
And again, if you watch that election, the lines of people, we have not seen that in Boston politically, people in lines waiting to vote. Somehow he had captured the hearts of the people, and people wanted to vote. We haven't seen that since the governor.
Right. So what happens, you get Mel King, who lays the groundwork, because he's sort of like the Jesse Jackson figure, right? The protest candidate, who actually mobilized and galvanized the entire black community and did a brilliant job. Then you have a couple of folk that take the shot. You have City Councilman Bruce Bowling, who ran for mayor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he took his shot. And then you have some other black individuals, but they're not really folk that are standing for the black community.
Right.
You know, what you do is you tell the black community, vote for me, or you play the gender card.
Mm.
And you say, I'm a woman, you vote for me, that means you're a good person.
Well, again, I have not, I'll be honest, I don't know if you've had. I had Ayanna Pressley in the studio when she was running, and we prayed with her. And everybody said she wasn't going to make it. Everybody said that.
Right.
And we prayed with her, and she talked her heart out here. There was script. Ayanna just talked. And then the next day, we picked up the newspapers, and she topped the ticket.
Right.
That was amazing. I understand how some of that happened.
Right.
But have we stopped to analyze what happened for her to try to apply it to what's happening in this election? And I think the answer to that is really no.
No. We haven't analyzed that. Mm-mm. We haven't analyzed the Mel thing or the fact that 40% of the electorate are undecided. So that means this thing is a wild, everything's a wild card.
Well, we're going to have to stop. We have a guest that's in the studio. We're going to talk in just a few moments to Michelle Wu, who's running for the Boston City Council at large. And we're going to listen to her and hear from her. And then right after her, Larry Ellison will be calling in. And we're going to be talking about the debate that's going on right now with the Boston Police Department. Really, it's not the Boston Police Department. It's Commissioner Ed Davis and Larry and Mamlio going back and forth at it. And we're going to hear Larry's side of what happened. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, we're going to be speaking to Michelle Wu, candidate for Boston City Council at large.
I ain't going to let you off the hook. I ain't got no young.
It's Customer Appreciation Day. It's going to be Sunday, October 6, 2013, starting at 2 p.m. and going all the way to 5. Join us and meet our restaurant staff and all the staff and members of Boston Praise Radio and TV. Down Home is going to give a free soda and dessert with every meal and 10% off your next Sunday dinner. We want to say hello and tell you how much we appreciate your business. So again, Sunday, October 6th, Sunday, October 6th, 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. at Down Home Delivery Restaurant at 2 Bolton Street in Dorchester. See you there.
Fifty years ago, one of the darkest chapters of the civil rights movement occurred. The bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church, killing four little girls who were in the church preparing to sing. On Sunday, September 15th, Walden Media commemorates this historical day with a special advanced screening of The Watsons Go to Birmingham, the tale of a summer journey that leaves a family and a nation forever transformed. The screening will be at the Strand Theater on 543 Columbia Road in Dorchester. Admission is free. Doors open at 4:30 p.m. There is limited seating. To reserve a seat, call 339-502-5850. Call 339-502-5850. That is 339-502-5850. After the screening, a march will take place from the Strand Theater to the Salvation Army Croft Community Center, where a reception will be held.
You're listening to Boston Praise Radio and TV. If you want to broadcast on our radio and television network, call us at 617-282-0685, 617-282-0685, or email us at bostonpraiseradio.tv at gmail.com, bostonpraiseradio.tv at gmail.com.
Should we earn a license for a resort casino? Caesars Resort at Suffolk Downs is expected to spend $150 million annually on local goods and services. We're having two business partnership forums on Tuesday, September 10th at the Reggie Lewis Community Center between 3 and 5 p.m. and 7 to 9 p.m. Learn how your business can partner with Caesars Resort at Suffolk Downs and hear from Caesars partners in other markets about the opportunities Caesars has created for their businesses. To RSVP, visit friendsofsuffolkdowns.com/events or text vendors to 44144. Women, minority, and veteran-owned businesses are welcome to attend. Tuesday, September 10th at the Reggie Lewis Community Center between 3 and 5 p.m. and 7 to 9 p.m.
of a hangman's rope. But soon some people began to fight against what they knew wasn't right. Blacks, Jews, and whites took a stand, and that is when all the marching began.
Still marching, we got tired.
We got
still
tired.
Marching, and we have.
Was in Selma, Alabama. Today we'll always remember on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, police stood in the way. It was the beginning of the Bloody Sunday. Dr. King knew that we would be attacked, but he said to everyone that we ain't turning back.
For the right to vote.
That's right.
So don't take it for granted, cause it ain't no joke.
That's right.
The battle's still long, but there's still hope.
That's right.
If you don't take actions, it will go up in smoke. It ain't that hard, it won't give you a stroke.
That's right.
But now it's time to get on the boat. If you don't get out and vote,
come on, my brother,
it would surely be all she wrote.
That's
so
right.
Let's dump the book. So let's dump the book. That's right. Let's dump the book. Come on.
Right.
Let's dump the book.
This is Pastor Bruce Wall, and you're listening to Boston Politics, and we're here every Tuesday from 9 p.m. until 12 midnight, and we're thanking you for tuning in every week and being a part of our broadcast. Jamal, thanks for being in the chat room. Pastor Odom and others who are watching and listening today, thank you for being a part of our broadcast. We have a special guest in the studio. Her name is Michelle, and she's running for the Boston City Council at large. Michelle, thank you for being on Boston Politics.
Thank you for having me.
We have 30 minutes to really unpackage a little bit about you and also this campaign. So let's talk a little bit about why you have decided to take this plunge and run for office.
Absolutely. It's a transformative time in the city of Boston with 19 at-large candidates running for city council at large. Yeah. And I remember back in December when I was the first one to step into the ring, mm-hmm. when I announced in early December that I wanted to run for city council at large to start the conversation about Boston and what I want to see for families across Boston. I'm running because I've experienced firsthand with my own family mm-hmm. how important city government is, mm-hmm. and I've just seen from so many different angles, raising my sisters, taking care of my mom, running a small business, mm-hmm. that city government is a place that can that really has a potential to support families.
What does your campaign look like? You said 19 candidates. It's amazing. What does it look like? What's the momentum like? How are you feeling about the potential or possibility of you winning a seat?
Across the city, it's incredibly exciting to see everyone plugging into politics. Unfortunately for us council candidates, most of the energy is focused on the mayoral race,
I know,
of the ticket.
I know.
It's a great thing for the city, though, that we are talking about issues from every angle, and there are lots of opportunities to find voters. So I find myself tagging along a lot to the mayoral events to meet voters there.
Sure.
But the council candidates are, we're also running all across the city, every opportunity at neighborhood associations, churches, knocking on doors, grocery stores, barbershops, we're out there.
So it's really the image of you being at a mayoral debate
with the Michelle Wu, right? Yes. Passing them out. Yep. Hi, how are you? What are some of the issues that you feel are important for you to focus on? What are they going to be? Click them off.
Sure. The overall theme of my campaign is building pipelines to opportunity.
Okay.
That I just believe Boston as a city has the resources to support families, but it's just a matter of getting those resources down into the neighborhoods where people are and increasing access, breaking down those barriers and obstacles. For me, the three biggest issues are around schools, small business, and innovation, defined really broadly. I think underlying all of that is a foundation of public safety as well.
Good. I'm glad you mentioned public safety because you're in Dorchester, which is a part of the city that's been experiencing a lot of the crime, a lot of the violence. So, again, what can a city councilor do to address the whole public safety crisis in Boston?
We start the conversation and we make sure that the city is held accountable on those conversations. You know, I have launched 50 ideas for Boston families, 50 specific things that I think the city could do right away to make life better. And when I launched this list of ideas, I took a tour around 13 different neighborhoods. Each stop was focusing on a different policy plank. But I found that stop after stop, wherever I went, whatever I was planning to talk about, public safety came to the front.
Always came up, yeah.
With small business owners, they said, we can't talk about how to make business better until customers feel safe coming here.
Good point.
With schools, it was the same thing.
So are there any, for example, we here at Boston Praise Radio, since 2005, I issued a community state of emergency with regards to homicides. And it didn't mean that I wanted the National Guard to come into Boston or we wanted curfews. I just wanted homicides to become a major, major concern that we began to study why it was happening in our city. And a number of the elected officials didn't want to go near it. And now with this election, everybody is saying we need to raise it as high as we can. Are there any specific plans that you have regarding the how do we address the homicides, the killings in the city?
Yeah, absolutely. I think for me, it all comes back down to a foundation of economic security and jobs. And it is about starting very early with that. So I've said, starting from our youth, they need to have access to mental health services and social services, crisis counseling in the schools.
That's critical. Yeah.
We need to have conflict resolution classes in the schools early on so youth know how to deal with issues that they are bringing in with them. Mm. You know, my mother is struggling with mental illness now, and she's doing much better these days, but I know the impact it has on one family and on an entire community. So our kids at a younger and younger age are dealing with this, and it's leading to issues down the road. We also need to be making sure that every single child, every single youth sees a clear pathway to jobs for themselves.
Sure.
Summer internships, paid opportunities during the school year, every opportunity we have to support kids and help them develop their skills. It's not about getting the degree. It's not about getting good MCAS scores. It's about getting a job, getting to that place where you have a means to support yourself and your family. I think so many of our public safety issues, substance abuse issues, all come from this lack of jobs in the neighborhoods. So really getting the resources down to the neighborhoods. Community policing is a huge piece of that as well. Really having a presence in the neighborhoods with people who are from the neighborhoods, who know the community, who care about the community and are invested.
We're going to give out the number. We have a call now. Okay. The number is 617-282-0685. 617-282-0685. If you want to join in on this conversation, you're welcome to call in. Caller, you're live on the air. Go right ahead.
Hey, Pastor. Good evening. And good evening, Michelle. It's Larry Ellison.
Good evening.
How are you? I consider Michelle a friend, and I'm just calling in to offer my support for her. I think she'll be a great city councilor. We've worked closely with her in the past on events with her with Elizabeth Warren, and she's shown to be a true leader, so we look forward to her plans on public safety and working with her in that area.
Yeah, isn't
Thank
it,
you so much.
Larry, isn't it amazing that we're actually starting with she's the one that said she's hearing public safety all over the place, and as you probably heard, I said we're in Dorchester, so that's something we're very concerned about, and she's clicking off real quick a number of the things that she would do as a city councilor to bring about change.
No, it's refreshing. You know, I met Michelle a little over a year or so ago, And, you know, I was very impressed by her story with how she's taking care of her family. So I know someone that is that deeply caring about their loved ones wants that same for everyone, and that just definitely comes across from Michelle.
Mm. Is there a question that you would like to ask her since you could be my co-host for a few minutes here?
Well, I just asked her, you know, I know she's talking about public safety. I think it's a very important issue because she's right. You know, it does tie into so many things. If you have a business and you don't feel safe operating, that means people aren't going to come in and spend money. That affects the community. And I work in the schools for the police, and I know kids that don't feel safe in school, it's very difficult for them to focus on that. I'm just wondering how she would work with the council because, you know, it doesn't seem to be that union. And I think the good thing here is that there seems to be almost going to be a real sweeping change in the city council. So that might help. But, I mean, I'm just, you know, curious of what she looks forward to doing in the council as a city council at large.
Okay. And, Sheil, thanks for calling, and we'll let her go ahead and respond to that. God bless you. Thanks, man.
Thank you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you so much, Larry. Absolutely. I think it's on the city council, it's about building coalitions and it's about bringing people together.
Yeah.
We will have a new mayor in office, no matter which of the 12 it is, it will be a new mayor and at least 4 new city councilors, 5 city councilors. So I have taken the time to meet with every single sitting city councilor to build those relationships. I've gotten endorsements from 15 state representatives and state senators. Mm-hmm. It's been important to me to reach out to all levels of government because we need cooperation across the board to get some of these things done.
It's one thing for an elected official to go into office making a lot of promises to their voting constituents, but you know, one person, you need a coalition in order to pass a vote. So coalition building is more important than making a whole lot of promises and then going back to the voters and saying, well, I tried, but you didn't build coalition. So that's what it sounds like you're already working on that.
Yeah, it is about building coalitions between elected officials, but more importantly, it's about those coalitions will happen if you're connected with the constituents they represent and out in the community and really building those relationships on the campaign trail. And that's part of the reason why I got in so early is I knew Boston is a big city and there are so many groups that I wanted to take the time to meet with properly.
The phone number is 617-282-0685, 617-282-0685. I'm sitting here with Michelle Wu, who is running for the Boston City Council at large. She's going for, I want to represent the entire city, and she's been working on this for a while. Go ahead, caller, you're live on the air.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
All right. This is Jamal Crawford, and I just wanted to, you know, say that I'm glad to hear you on the airwaves of Boston Praise, and I want to ask you a little bit of an out of the realm of politics question, and one more on race relations.
Sure.
Now, you know, me myself, I'm a black community activist. What a lot of people don't know about me is that my child's mother is from the Philippines. And then, you know, ergo, my daughter is half black and half Filipino. One thing that has often, you know, puzzled me in politics and just in general relations is, what ways do you think that we can improve relations between the black and the Asian community? Because particularly here in Boston, you know, when we talk about groups of color and people of color, it's often, you know, black Latino, black Cape Verdean, and I feel like a lot of times Asian people get left out of it. Oftentimes as well, too, I notice that, like, let's take stand-up comedy, for instance. You know, Asian people are like one of the last groups that it's still okay to make fun of, whether it's the, you know, kung fu flick accents and, you know, da-da-da-da. And then, you know, and then in our community on a day-to-day basis, our interactions are oftentimes limited to the, you know, the Chinese restaurant, the, you know, the nail salon, the hair thing, and there's a lot of those type of stereotypes that exist, and we're not able to really break down that. So I would like to hear your, your thoughts on the relationship between the Asian community and the larger community of color, and specifically with the Black community.
That's a good question.
Yeah, absolutely, and thank you, Jamal, for that. I look to your blog from time to time too, and appreciate the leadership that you show every day.
Thank you.
So this is, again, one of the reasons why I threw my name in the ring. You know, obviously don't expect anyone to vote for me because I'm Asian American or a woman or anything like that, but I do see a lack of examples out there across the country. Asian Americans are very underrepresented, and I think part of it is because there is this barrier when it comes to coalition building. There are very few places in the country where Asians are the predominant majority, and it's been tricky to build coalitions because, as you say, there's often sort of this perceived black-brown coalition, and we're not, Asian Americans are not quite always in that, and we're not quite always, but at, you know, we're often seen as the quote-unquote model minority, when in fact there's just as much gang involvement and youth violence in many Asian American communities. The tricky part is that it is such a diverse community, not just in language, with people speaking all different languages in their cultural backgrounds, but in socioeconomic status. So you have very successful professionals who are doctors and lawyers and engineers, scientists, and then you have the recent immigrants who desperately need affordable housing and are struggling to get by. So it's been hard even sometimes to unite the community itself behind a set of issues. I am so excited about the opportunity to continue building these coalitions. I think we see often events where, you know, where one group will celebrate, whether it's a certain cultural festival or Chinese New Year or August Moon Festival. There needs to be a broad invitation across the board. And again, I think it starts with leadership, where if elected, I would be so thrilled to bring everyone into the Chinese community celebrations and create that space where we are having these conversations and talking about commonalities, because there are so many across the board.
And I leave you with this. One thing that really bothers me about, at least what I experience in my own community, is oftentimes we don't take the time to get to know each other. So, for instance, in my community, when the Latino population started to, you know, increase in Roxbury, many people said stuff like, the Puerto Ricans are taking over.
Yeah.
But they were speaking about people who were Dominicans, who were from Honduras. Right. I mean, like, so it was like, wow, hold on. And in the community, and at least for me, many people only think of the Asian community as Chinese or whatnot. And I remember what happened to Sam Yoon when he ran, right? Because Sam Yoon, of course, was called, you know, the Chinese candidate. And, of course, you know, he's Korean, right? So I think that there are, you know, some things that we could do to just take a little bit more time and be respectful of each one's individual cultures and histories, because they are very different and they represent very different things. But I just wanted to bring that up, and I'm very appreciative of your answer, and I'm very glad that Pastor Bruce Wall and the entire Boston Praise Radio team had you on, because it's interesting to hear, and I'll let you go on and talk, because I'm probably going to try to sneak another call in when Larry Ellison comes on.
Jamal, I hear that Michelle is going to be a bridge builder, a powerful bridge builder for the city, not just for her community, but for the city. And I'm excited with her actually sitting here with us tonight, starting this bridge building and this relationship on Boston Praise Radio.
Thank you. Yes, indeed.
Okay, ma'am.
I want to just add, to make one more connection with that point back into the political realm, in that I think, you know, yes, it's about bridge building, but it's about kind of being there, pushing it along too, because you know, I'm out every single weekday morning at a different T station, passing out flyers, trying to meet people all across the city. And it is frustrating, because I notice certain trends in which people don't want to take the flyer at all. They don't want to pay attention to politics, and it's often young people who are, you know, plugged into their iPhones and just want to get on the train, go to their job, and aren't thinking about city government. And I want to make sure that young people, Asian Americans also, another group that needs to get more politically involved, so that we can have these conversations and focus on what exactly culture means and examine these the specifics so that people don't have this general stereotype of the kung fu flicks, as Jamal was saying. So I think part of it, yes, is emphasizing the commonalities between communities of color across the board, the distinctions between Asian Americans as a group, but also pushing everyone to get more involved in politics, because that is how you make the change.
Jamal?
Yes, sir.
And you're getting more involved in politics, correct?
Yeah, a little bit.
Thanks, man. I can't wait till you
call. We're doing a little something.
Yeah, a little something.
Yeah.
We'll be, don't forget, at 10:30, as you have indicated, Ma'am Leo, and we'll be talking with us tonight.
Yeah, I can't wait. And, okay. and you know, I tell you what, too, last word for my newfound sister, Michelle. You definitely have a better shot of advancement on city council than you do if you were to enter into the Boston Police Department.
I like that. See you later, my friend.
Okay,
bye-bye. Thanks, Jamal. Let's talk a little bit about education. So we have charter schools. We have the Boston Public Schools. We talk about student choice. So, and we're going to have a new superintendent coming in. So what are some of your thoughts just regarding education? What should we do to improve our schools?
Education is probably the most personal topic for my family and me. I am still the legal guardian of my littlest sister, and she is in 11th grade now, still in the Boston Public Schools. So it's something we see every single day. I really believe that education is the means to break cycles and to change trajectories for students. My parents immigrated to this country with nothing, just so that they could keep improving their career and buying that smallest house in the best school district they could afford. It was all about giving us kids that pathway. So the way I see it, Boston is surrounded by resources. We have the best colleges in the country. We have hospitals that, you know, people come from all around the world to get care at, institutions, cultural and civic groups. We have it all here. But it's just a matter of breaking that gap and increasing access. There's no reason why by the end of their time in the Boston Public Schools, a student shouldn't have visited 10 universities out of all the ones that are here in Boston and gone to a tech company at the seaport and visited an accounting firm, financial services. They should know all of the options that are available to them in the city and have the schools that are preparing them for it. So on the public versus charter divide, I visited many schools. I took a tour of about 10 schools at the end of last school year, and just to see from teachers and principals what the issues really are. And I think some great things are happening in charter schools, some great thing happening in public schools. We need to be having these conversations and making sure the best practices are flowing back and forth. And I want to make sure that our public schools, which are catching all students, still have the funding and resources to succeed.
Now, the selection of the next superintendent is the responsibility of the mayor of the city of Boston. The superintendent, though, has to submit their budget to the city council through the mayor's budget, or is it independent? Do you know?
I believe it is voted on by the school committee as an approval process, but then goes into the regular budget.
Okay, so I'm hoping that the Boston City Council can have some direct impact on what's going on in our schools via the budgetary process and challenging them. My children have been in the public school and the charter school. They have fared very well in a chartered school, in chartered schools. And one of the other things in this community, we have the Medco program where a lot of kids are actually bussed out. And talking to one of the mayoral candidates, they were talking about quality schools and that they were saying that too many of the families had to say, if I want a quality education for my children, I have to make a choice that's outside of the community. And the candidate was saying, it's about time that if I want to make if I want a quality school, that I could either go outside or I have the option right in my neighborhood. How do we achieve that right in the neighborhoods?
I think it's an issue of funding and community engagement.
Okay.
So I've seen from my sister's schools that it is completely possible to take a school from underperforming status to one of the top in the district in a matter of 2-3 years.
Okay.
And we've seen it all across the district, examples of huge success, but it comes back to money. So there's this funny incentive where when the scores aren't so high when mm-hmm. they're underperforming. Mm-hmm. They get money from the state, turnaround funds. Mm-hmm. The principal can then expand the staff. They can bring in extra programming, mm-hmm. support the kids, mm-hmm. add mentoring. As soon as the scores start to come back up and they lose the turnaround status, that
the
money goes away.
Go.
And so there was a huge burden on us as parents and legal guardians to fill that gap. And I've talked to parents across the city, often in the better schools, better higher quality schools, that are fundraising $25,000, $30,000 a year mm-hmm. so that there's paper and pencils in classrooms. Mm-hmm. This is it's a matter of resource allocation. I believe that we need to think very carefully about what is happening in the central district office that could be supporting more of the schools to take more off of principals' plates, and then trying to push resources down so that schools across the board are high quality and can sustain that transition regardless of whether the community has the resources to fund it.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to give you some time now. That camera, the big camera, there are three cameras in the studio, but I'm going to have you just look at that camera, and you'll be looking at all the people that are watching you now, and I want you to make the case for why people who listen to Boston Praise Radio, we're the voice of the church in New England, why they should vote for you. I'm going to give you the next 5 minutes. It's yours. I'm backing away, taking my headphones off, and it's all yours.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to tune in and to learn a little bit more about me. As I said, family is the foundation of everything that I do. I'm the oldest of four kids, and grew up watching my immigrant parents struggle, learn English, and fight many, many barriers. I am so lucky that I had the opportunity to come to Boston for school and for resources. When my mom got sick, I took over parenting my two sisters, and 6 years later, I'm really happy to report that the city of Boston has given us everything. My mom is doing much better. My sisters are doing great. But I know how much privilege my family has. I speak English, I'm an attorney, and we need to make it so that every single family is supported by the resources that our city has. I believe it's completely possible if we just create pipelines to opportunity for families, connecting resources to the neighborhoods. It's about schools, it's about public safety, it's about housing, all of these issues that the city council can start the conversation with and keep pushing the administration to make change on. So I know what it's like on the other end of the phone when you're calling your city councilor's office and that is not the first call you've made. It is an urgent matter. You're struggling. So I believe most of all that the city councilor's role is to provide quality constituent services, to be there as a hub of information for you and your family when you need anything at all. So I pledge to always be that accessible, responsive resource, not just in the city hall office, but out in the community, because that's what it's really about. I've learned from Elizabeth Warren, who is my law school professor, and from working on her campaign, that you get out into the streets, to barbershops, churches, nail salons, and you meet people there. And the more that you are accessible, the more that you are hearing what's actually happening in Boston, at the family level, the more you can help and the more you can understand how to connect resources to those in need. So I very humbly and respectfully ask for one of your four votes. September 24th, exactly 2 weeks away from today, is a preliminary election. You get up to four votes. The top eight of us 19 candidates will make it on to the next round, and I need your help to get there. So I will be an advocate for all families across the city, but I know what it's like to struggle, and I believe that we can get there with the resources that Boston has.
I want to thank Michelle Wu for coming into Boston Praise Radio and TV, and again, as all of you know, we are the voice of the church in New England, so I'm calling on all of the members of the churches who are registered voters to vote on Election Day, September 24th. This is our first opportunity to have Michelle here in the studio. We hope that we can have her on again and again. And I'm hoping that you will seriously look at her campaign literature. Look at the literature, study who she is, go to her website. You can read all about her on the website. If you have any questions about her, you can, why don't you give out a phone number where people can call you?
The campaign number is 617-652-0136.
You can just give her campaign a call, and you might actually want to work for her. And so, again, I want to thank you for coming in.
Thank you so much, Pastor.
We're going to be Larry Ellison is actually going to be calling in just a few moments, and we're going to be talking about the Boston Police Department and Mamleo. And I'm hoping that on your way home, you might be able to listen to it. It's going to be very, very informative. So, again, thanks for coming in.
Thank you so much.
And God bless you. Thank you so much for being with us for this half hour. In just a few moments, we're going to be talking to Larry Ellison, representing Mamleo, and having a thorough discussion about his decision to go toe-to-toe with the police commissioner who has decided to go toe-to-toe with Mamleo. We'll be right back in just a few moments.
Bruce Wall. You will not want to miss the Down Home Delivery Restaurant's Customer Appreciation Day. It's going to be Sunday, October 6, 2013, starting at 2 p.m. and going all the way to 5. Join us and meet our restaurant staff and all the staff and members of Boston Praise Radio and TV. Down Home is going to give a free soda and dessert with every meal and 10% off your next Sunday dinner. We want to say hello and tell you how much we appreciate your business. So again, Sunday, October 6th, Sunday, October 6th, 2 p.m. to 5 p.m. at Down Home Delivery Restaurant at 2 Bowden Street in Dorchester. See you there.
Fifty years ago, one of the darkest chapters of the civil rights movement occurred. The bombing of the 16th Street Baptist Church, killing four little girls who were in the church preparing to sing. On Sunday, September 15th, Walden Media commemorates this historical day with a special advanced screening of The Watsons Go to Birmingham, the tale of a summer journey that leaves a family and a nation forever transformed. The screening will be at the Strand Theater on 543 Columbia Road in Dorchester. Admission is free. Doors open at 4:30 p.m. There is limited seating. To reserve a seat, call 339-502-5850. Call 339-502-5850. That is 339-502-5850. After the screening, a march will take place from the Strand Theater to the Salvation Army Croc Community Center, where a reception will be held.
You're listening to Boston Praise Radio and TV. If you want to broadcast on our radio and television network, call us at 617-282-0685, 617-282-0685, or email us at bostonpraiseradio.tv@gmail.com.